What would you tell somebody about war?
War is just so senseless, really, it is. The guy that starts the war, he's 10 feet, 10, I mean, he's 10 stories down in the goddamn hole, and you're fighting his war for him. Sending these poor kids that are 16, 17 years old. Don't even know what the hell they're doing. And one day I had to kill one of them like that because he was a young kid. He's coming out with his rifle, and when I got away from the house to turn into the yard, I saw him start to bring the rifle down. I had to kill this guy because he would have killed me. But he maybe was 16 years old. Now to me, I says, well, that's not right.
There's not too many people, I guess, that have reunions anymore because, you know, this is the 50th year that we're having this thing. And every year, you know, you keep coming back and coming back. And, this might maybe be the last one. I don't know.
People were like brothers to me. But these guys you're with, you sleep with them, you eat with them, you train with them, you go into combat with them, and they're there, you're there. They're my family.
Killed anybody here. In fact, I'm glad I don't know. I don't know if I fired at a guy and saw him go down and I know I killed him, I don't know how I'd feel. And thank God I don't know what.
Nice going, boy. Frodo, here.
I was having a good time, and I had a job, and I'm not the fighting type. In other words, I was drafted, and I was very unhappy to get drafted. There's nothing you can do about it. This is the way it's gonna be, so you accept it. I didn't believe in wars, and they don't accomplish a thing, but they make a lot of guys money, see? We'll be right back.
you see these guys greet one another. You know, I haven't seen a guy for a year, and they come up and they hug one another.
I think it's been a couple of years now since we've had what the reunion people call a first-timer, the first time they ever come to a reunion. But when you get somebody there for the first time, most of them tend to come back.
Krzyzewski or Krzyzewski, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he was here.
That's his first time here.
He was here a little while ago, and he's the one that said this is his first time he's here.
There aren't too many first-timers anymore, you know.
Oh, well, if you come first time by now, this might maybe be the last one.
The 95th Division, I think, was one of the well-trained outfits that could go and fight anywhere in the world.
We were a hard division. They take us from Palm Springs in December, where it's 100 degrees out there. They take you on a train. You don't know where you're going. You wind up in Pennsylvania, zero weather. They don't put you in nice cars to take you. They put you in open trucks, and the cold wind is hitting you. Your nose and your snots are just all frozen up. When you get there, you can't even feel yourself. So they dump you out of the trucks, and there you are.
We went out to the desert and had desert training because we had all kinds of training. And you go out in that desert, and you got to pick up butts and all that, and it was really good training.
You know, when they sent me the mule packing school, I says, what are you giving me? What are you giving me the mule? I don't know. Give it to the farmer that knows what he's doing. No, he knows what he's doing. I want you to learn it. You know, I don't know one end from another from a mule packing thing.
You know, there's the Army way and there's the right way. Everything you do in the Army is, it's all screwed up. You know, the training that they gave us. We got into Camp Swift and we're digging trenches in that Texas clay because they thought they were going to fight it like World War I. You get me? We're digging trenches. There ain't no trench warfare over here. It's house to house.
When I got to Camp Swift, okay, I weighed 116 pounds. And the first thing, the guy hands me this BAR. Now, the BAR is a 21-pound thing, weighs 21 pounds, and I'm only 116 pounds. I asked the first sergeant, why are you giving me a gun that's 21 pounds and 20 pounds of ammunition, and I'm only 116 pounds? Why are you doing that? Well, he says, you should be good because you're from Chicago. What's that got to do with anything?
Happy to see these reunions take place. You know, by having them every year, the guys don't get a chance to age so much that we don't know them, you know. But it is an amazing revelation the first time you come here after 40 years or so and you haven't seen these guys in that length of time.
Comradeship. That's something, you know, that's something that is unique among veterans. You've been there, you've done that, and you love each other, and you look out for each other. After you've been through it, you know that you can't help yourself and you don't want to.
When I got out of the war, I never talked about it. Who was I going to talk to? Who could I talked to that would realize what we went through? You have to witness it and be in it before you really fully understand it.
We didn't want to talk about any of it, you know, because killing wasn't our bag. You know, I never killed anything, and I go in the Army, and it's legalized to kill, see, which is another thing that upsets your insides. Because you're home in peaceful country, and you're not supposed to hurt anybody, not even an animal. And you go over there and they say, you know, get going and let them have it, see?
Nobody likes to kill anybody. It's just some things happen and that's it. There's nothing that you can't stop living. You can't worry about it the rest of your life, otherwise you're going to live a miserable life.
It didn't bother me to see a dead German. You know, you walk across the field and here's these Germans are laying out there dead. And then you see one of our guys out there and you look, and that bothered me because that could be me laying there.
Over in the war, there's no respect for the dead, because if you die in an ambulance, they take you out and put you alongside the road because they only want to carry people they can cure in an ambulance. They just set you in the road. And then what you see, which is one of the things that's back in my head and I'll never forget it, is 2.5-ton trucks going along the road and picking them poor people up and sliding them in the truck. And they're piled up like core wood in a truck. And that's one of the big things where the guys are never gonna forget that. You know, I stand on my head for 300 counts on a Monday and a Friday. And it's supposed to grow my hair. I had to have my hair in a coffin so I look nice.
Oh, God.
Come on in, guys. You'll love this family. You'll see the pumpkins. You'll see our pumpkins.
Make it.
Oh. Where's the shot at?
No, you can get to shoot wherever you want.
Oh, yeah? Believe it or not, the grandchildren now they're interested in this. Like, my grandchildren keep questioning me, you know, about it. I don't go into the stuff that I don't want to talk about it. You know, I talk about general. I don't bring in the somebody alongside of me is dead or they threw the bodies in a 2.5-ton truck. I don't bring that up. They're wonderful kids. You know, they're very good kids, and they're never going to get rid of me because I'm too angry to get rid of.
Days and nights it's raining, 14 days and nights there. And on top of that, you got nowhere to go. You dig a hole, you put these logs that you cut the trees on top. Then on top of that, you put your tent on top of there and you fill it with dirt. So when it rains, the water's not going to drip all over you. And you're sitting in this hole like an animal.
And the mud over in France, I don't know, I don't think there's any other country that's got the kind of mud they have over there. You start marching down in a column, and you're halfway in the column, and by the time you get there, you're that deep in mud.
This guy was the greatest. You'll go to hell and back for him. Like they used to ask him, you know, in the movie, well, do you think your men will do that? You know, that's pretty risky. My men will do anything, he says. Because he's the type of guy that'll go out right in front line with you. He's not going to hit the ground when he hears a shell. And if you're officers with him, don't you do it, because he's liable to shoot you himself. Because he's going to say, these poor soldiers out here in that mud and that, and you hit the ground, I'll blow your brains out if you do that.
There was a saying, old blood and guts Patton. His guts and our blood. He might have been a great general and did a lot of things, but that statement that he made, it hurt us. It really hurt us.
You know, in the war, the foot soldier, you don't read nothing about him. You read about General Patton. You read about MacArthur, but you don't read about the foot soldier because they don't know nothing about him. weren't blindfolded that it was this was just a war. We had a wider scope to where we knew we had a fight, but we had to have some kind of way to blow off steam. So during the combat, we blew off steam because it was house-to-house fighting. We'd get a town, and we'd hit the liquor store and get champagne and wine and accordions and skis and typewriters. And that is what took the focus off of war. So otherwise, you'd flip your lid.
Patton said, I'm taking Metz. Regardless of what you guys say, you go the first time, you take it. Because if you don't, the second time you go in, it's going to be a lot harder because by then they're going to be prepared for you. And he says, I don't pay for real estate twice. That's his saying, and which I don't blame him.
They moved us up, and the assignment from Corps was to take Metz.
In the 4th century of our time, the Roman military governor, his name was Metius, where we think the name of Metz come from, because it was Metensis, Metis, and finally Metz, as we know today, from the 5th century on. It is one of the oldest cities in Europe, and why the historians are thinking this way is after the defeat of Napoleon III in the Franco-Prussian War, the Prussian archaeologists did a lot of researches here, and in particular with the famous Roman aqueduct. And it is at the famous nymphaeum of this Roman aqueduct that the archaeologists have found two bifaces. A biface is, of course, a carving and a cutting tool. And through analysis at the scientific center in Paris, the analysis revealed that the two bifaces go back to the Paleolithic era of mankind. We're talking about 200,000 years before Jesus Christ.
The Moselle was the first incident that where we lost 85% of our men.
And so, it was a little island.
Yeah, but there's
in the middle.
These are all islands on all the way here, you know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Island here, because on the other side of the canal, like
it's full. It's full of the islands here, okay. All along.
Yeah.
Yeah. See where I crossed, there was no canal. We were further downstream.
It was an island like that one there. See that island there?
Yes. Well, that's possible.
The water,
you know,
on both
that's
sides.
That's right. Yeah, that's very possible.
We had to throw a line across, so the guys could hold on to it, put the planking down, hold the assault boats, put the planking down, and we lost some. And Colonel says, "I don't want you to lose assault boats." He says, "If you this peps you up, it takes me a long time to get an assault boat. I'd rather have you lose men, because I can get men faster than I can at a salt boat."
But hey, all along here, man.
Stuff. Oh, there's a lot of dead guys along here. A lot of dead guys.
There's probably still some of us in the river.
They had the Moselle covered from all angles with artillery fire and mortar fire and the 88s. And it was, you just couldn't do anything without being shelled.
But this was really the start of real bad combat,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right here.
Yeah, that was our initiation, boy.
Yeah. A lot of memories here.
Yeah.
We lost like. Yeah. That's a tearjerker. That is.
Well, that was right there, buddy.
Yeah, that was there. You telling me? I was ready to jump in.
The city of Metz here is the only city in the world, and I repeat myself, the only city in the world where you can see all the known fortifications constructed by mankind.
The enemy was all dug in there. There was a little Polish kid who was 12 years old. And I was talking to him in Polish. And he says, better tell your commandant that there's not regular soldiers in them things. They're all SS troopers.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
And they've got the best equipment. Yeah. If you start attacking them, you're all going to die.
That was
so I finally told our captain, and he got the planes in there and bombed the shit out of them people. When morning came, there was nothing left there. Yeah. It tore it all up. But if we would have gone up there, they'd have killed every one of us.
This was the first time we got on the front line. No experience or nothing. So this guy with the machine gun gets down there, and his ammunition carrier is alongside. He blasts off with that machine gun. All of a sudden, bang, they hit this guy right in the head. Holy shit. And I'm there next to him, and I says, wait a minute. I'm not going to fire this gun. If I do, I'm going to move. So the ammunition guy was trying to take care of this guy. So what I did was I blast off 20 rounds, you know, out of the gun. And when I did that, I rolled over with the thing and I moved over a little bit. You know what I mean? Sure enough, as soon as I moved over, I could see the blast hitting the dirt with some machine gun was hitting down there to get me. I says, holy crap, that's it. Now I know what to do.
When you're in combat, there's nobody around to tell you what to do. Go that way, go this way, go that way. You're the one.
At first, you know, nothing's going to happen to me. I'm going to be all right. And then you get to the point that the law of averages are going to catch up with me. I've been here too long and missed too many times. One of these, you go from this, you know, there's not one meant for me to, well, maybe, and then it's going to be when.
And being only 18 years old, you know, this is an adventure. And then I realized at that time, I said, hey, you know, a guy can get killed here. And I woke up.
Metz is a very, very beautiful city. It is an unknown city that the people coming to visit Paris and the south of France, they have no idea of how beautiful the city of Metz is. It was one of the main crossroads of the Roman Empire in the 3rd century of our time.
Metz was a fortified city which over the centuries had never been taken, you know, by storm. It always, if it ever capitulated, it was just either by long siege or they just gave up to start with.
The people, when they're watching this thing, have to have an idea of what you're talking about. So when you tell them this place has never been taken because, it was too hard to take. If you look around Metz, no matter where you go, there's all kind of pillboxes. And you can't do anything if you go down there and you get into you find a pillbox. Where do you go?
You've got bunkers by the hundreds around this
right.
City. Hundreds of bunkers.
Yeah. You come down here, you wonder how any of us ever got out of this thing. Because if you were walking through here during the war, you never know, is there a hole there? Is there a hole there? Somebody's aiming at you, gonna kill you. And you see on top, they got ground and trees up on the top. So when you're in a plane,
you don't even know
that it's there.
You know.
You can't bomb them because you think it's ground.
That's right, exactly.
This Colonel Kelly, he wanted this particular pillbox eliminated because it had this automatic turret. So we sent our guys up, but they didn't know there was 10 inches of steel in them turrets, you know, and they never got it, and they shot all our guys. We lost 5 guys. So our lieutenant, he told this Colonel Kelly that was across the river in a safe place, if you want that pillbox, you know, come over and get it yourself.
All steel things on the windows, steel doors, How you gonna break in when a tank, a 90 millimeter can't go through there, and you're gonna get a GI to try to bust into these things? You can't. Now you understand why you can't tell people, you know, in words when you come back home what this is, you know, what the problems you had with it. You have to see it before you really understand it. And then you say, how in the world did you ever get back out of here? You know, it's frightening.
We're now in the ancient medieval quarters of the city of Metz. In the center here, we come to the famous Saint Olivier's Church. And of course, Saint Olivier is a famous saint that was executed by the Romans. They cut his head off. And he took his head in his hands, and he walked about 10 to 100 meters, we don't know, and he set the head down, and he said, this is where I want a church to be built.
We moved so fast that most of the time I never did see our mess guys, you know, the mess truck. I never did see it because we ate on the way. We went into houses and ate their food, and we killed animals and cooked them. We shot a cow, and we had a carbine. And the cow, this guy Hackett, he shot the cow, boom, boom. Shot him five times, seven times. And the cow just say, moo, that son of a gun and cow won't die, see? So Hackett was a butcher in Kansas, and he gets his knife out and he slits his throat. And we cut that cow up, and they talk about E. coli. We cut that cow up, and the guys skinned it, and we held it up for, it was cold though. It was in December. And we ate that meat, just slice it off and eat it. It wasn't stamped by any government or anything. It was stamped by Hackett.
We came into a town one time, and you know what? They shelled it so much that there were bodies laying all over the streets. Here's a horse that's walking down the street, got five or six bullets in him, he's bleeding. There's five women following him with knives in their hands, so when he drops dead, they cut him up for the meat. Now you justify that to this country. You tell me that. Would anybody in this country do that? They'd say you're crazy.
To break the monotony of the war, you talk to the French girls, and we weren't supposed to talk to the German girls, but we did, because it was $65 fine, but it was worth it to talk to the girls, because them German girls were really good looking. And you forget about bullets and everything when you do a little fraternizing, because I loved that.
Don't give any information.
It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's just talk about love, 'cause that's what I'm thinking of. And
it's no military secret.
Can you translate for me?
What do you want to ask?
Does he do the manual of arms in 16 count?
No, huh? They do not know that.
Well, I show them.
All right.
May I?
Why?
We start off here at port. I mean it.
To find two places where I had been, you know, actually at that spot 55 years before, never in my wildest dreams would I have thought I would have ever been back and located those places. To me, it was an opportunity to be there the first time. It was an opportunity to be there the second time. Hey, Steve. Let me get your picture. I remember Mueller being killed over there, Ingalls being killed over here, and then after Dogger Squad got clobbered, the captain decided it wasn't anything that a rifle company could do against that structure down there, so he pulled back, and then we withdrew back through these woods on either side of this road back to Jersey Sioux, and that's where we were surrounded for the next 3 days.
And see that hole there? They got it aimed right for your heart. And the minute that the gun goes off, he kills you if you walk through any one of these passes. This is a huge one right here. Like this one here, you'd have to wait them out, because there's no way in the world you're going to get them.
I think it's attributed to a German officer at Metz that referred to the 95th as the Iron Men. I guess it's because we hung in there. I mean, I like to think that's maybe why it is.
And the Führer says, wie ist the master race? Wie heil, heil! Right in the Führer's face, not to love the Führer is a great disgrace. So wie heil, heil! Right in the Führer's face. When Herr Goebbels says, we own the world in space. Wie heil, heil! Right in Herr Goebbels' face. When Herr Göring says, they'll never bomb this place. Wie heil, heil!
The town took a big beating. They tore the thing up. Their planes tore it up. Our planes tore it up.
This is the bridge. This bridge is.
That's the bridge.
That one right there.
That's it, right? Okay. No, that's it.
That's it. Yeah.
That, all they've done is widened it. The Germans were shelling this area all the time, mm-hmm. so I don't think there's anything original mm-hmm. anywhere in here. And then I believe the 26th didn't attack out until after the 1st of March. Mm-hmm. So that's three solid months that the Germans were shelling. Later the day we crossed the river and took the bridge, that day to the next day, it was practically all German artillery. And it was said at the time, and maybe later, that was the heaviest German artillery barrage of World War II. I mean, they were trying to blow that bridge.
The 1690, and that was built in 1697. That's how long that thing's been here. It's unbelievable, really. And it might be here for another couple thousand years. We're in this house that the machine gunners were setting up the machine gun in the front windows, four of them. And my platoon sergeant was up on the same floor up there, because we were in the basement and this was up on the second floor. So here comes this real big shell, comes inside of the house, explodes on the second floor, kills these four guys, and the concussion of the shell killed my platoon sergeant. Then we said, we gotta get out of here. So the first guy takes off, and the guys that were in that building down there had a Schmeisser machine gun. 1,500 rounds a minute that thing does. So this guy runs down into the garage, and I see these bullets fall on his head. You know what I mean? I said, holy shit, what is that? So then they said, okay, you're next to go. And I said, man, did you see that? They said, yeah, but we gotta get into that garage. You gotta get going, you know what I mean? So I said, okay, I'm gonna go. The minute I passed that building,
And I heard them 30 slugs, like that. And that's when one hit me.
We crossed the bridge. I'll show you where I got hit. I remember exactly.
Go straight ahead, yeah.
Yeah, in that area.
Yeah, go straight ahead. I want to find a railroad station.
I think this is whatever that one is.
On the map, I can't visualize it on the map. I have to see it in person.
All right, that's the railroad station. That's straight ahead of it.
From what I thought, that the strange station was right this way, or maybe it was on an angle. I really don't know.
Okay.
All I know is I took a fast look and said, we want to get out of there in a hurry, see? Right. So I don't know if it was straight or if it was on an angle.
Yeah. See, we're standing right here. That's the railroad station. Yeah. It's over my right shoulder. And that's the street right there. That's the street right there.
This has got to be the street. The doctor said, you know what? You're lucky you were the height you were. He said, if you were 2 inches lower, they'd have caught you through the neck and you'd have died. If you were 2 inches higher, they'd have gone through there and hit your heart and you'd have been dead. So he says, consider yourself lucky that you got the hit at the height you were. Because he caught me right here. Which, if it had been a little higher, it would have got me right through the neck. Now, this is 30 slugs he threw at me. That Schmeisser machine, you know how that is? You know how 30 bullets sound? That's it. 30 slugs are at you. That's how fast that gun operates. But he must have hit me with the first one, because the rest of them must have gone flying. Can you imagine 1,500 rounds a minute? I can't see why anybody would build a gun like that.
Let's roll here a minute now.
There's a little something right here.
Yeah, that's a creek. That's a creek. Yeah. That's the backside of the creek.
Then it's that building right
there. Oh! You see the silo?
Yeah.
In December, I was probably in a house where this house on the corner right here is. I remember being in that area on Christmas Day and Christmas Eve. I may have been here.
Amerikaner. Yeah. Soldat.
Yeah.
Yeah,
here. December 44. Here.
Mühle.
You're Mueller?
Ich wohne hier. Ich bin hier geboren.
Oh, it was then. Yeah. There was a mill here. We were in this house in Charlotte. In fact, it was a house that we found in November of 99 that I'd been in on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. And one day somebody hollered, there's some Germans walking across the field. And everybody, most of them, ran to the window and looked. And some started shooting, and I was shooting. And then I heard a machine gun. Well, the two Germans fell. I don't know whether I hit him or somebody else hit him. And then that later on was when Stanley Kozlowski and I went out to see if they had anything on them. I noticed that one of them had been carrying a rifle and the other one didn't. I assumed that he was probably an officer and had a pistol. And at that time, I didn't have any souvenir, and I thought, well, a pistol would be nice.
Si tu veux prendre le sac, bon, c'est pas grave. Moi, autrement, faut virer ça.
Ah, on peut pas prendre le sac.
Ouais, tu... Voilà. Si tu peux prendre le sac, prends ton sac, tourne. C'est bon, pas de problème.
Did you see the one with the steel pipe? He got a package of Lucky Strike stuck in the van going around the steel pipe?
No.
Did you see him right up through there?
Yep.
Cigarette pack stuck in his
yeah.
side of his helmet there.
Yeah.
Lucky Strike, boy, you hadn't seen that in a long time.
Yeah. He must have saved that as a souvenir. Lucky Strike.
Thank you.
When I first heard about the trip that they were going over back over to France, I said, well, I think I'd like to go. I was kind of hesitant right up to before I went to the airport. And then once I got over there, I changed my outlook on that entirely. I think it was the best thing I've ever done. It brought back a lot of, let's say, unpleasant memories, but it brought back a lot of good memories. And to see and appreciate how these people feel about us, that was one of the biggest things.
Now you see the swan there? These two, I don't know what they're doing there, but there's about 24 on the other bridge. And when the bell, the big bell rings, they all turn their heads toward the bell. Okay, we're standing here in front of the famous German door in 1552, when the emperor, Charles V, wanted to take back the city into the German fold. He attacked here, and the military governor resisted the attack and the siege of the Emperor Charles V. And there's a plaque, unfortunately we cannot see it. We have the military governor at that time, the Sire of Dex, which has a sculpture. He has his pants down and is showing his rear end to the Emperor.
Hey, Jesus, don't you wish we had that when we were fighting? That rifle?
That looks like quite a weapon.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's the MK-14.
I don't know. After the war was over, they designed all good rifles.
Oh, yeah. Oh, hey.
There was nothing wrong with mine.
Oh, mine stunk.
I thought the M1 was all right.
Mine stunk.
You know, you can look back and see every battle we had, we lost a lot of guys.
Yeah.
I mean, in fact,
we were lovers. We weren't fighters.
That's right.
One of the people asked me.
I wasn't mad at nobody.
When I finally got back to the outfit, I says, did you recognize anybody in your company? I says, well, a couple of them, but it's surprising how
they're
many.
They're all gone.
Yeah, yeah.
The
original guys are
original
gone.
Original guys were gone.
90% gone.
That's Sunday Metz hour. That's the main thing of the reunion.
Andrew R. Arnold, Company I, 377th Infantry. William D. Atchison, Battery B, 547th AAA. Larry A. Atizano, Battery B, 920th Field Artillery. Clarence E. Axtell, Company E.
It's a service
Infantry.
To recognize and pay
George
tribute
Bidard,
to the men who
Division
have died
Band.
In the past year since our last reunion.
Daniel N. Benjamin.
When you get in there, I've been going
Infantry.
There all the time, and you still cry.
Bill Bickers.
A man cries,
Battery
and the
B,
women cry. And as you guys
artillery.
Notice, it's really...
Wayne Bliss.
It pulls at the heartstrings.
Company C, 378th Infantry.
How did this? I sewed it on.
Why?
Why? Because I'm proud of the 95th. Just like I wear anything else of it. I wear the pins. Wouldn't you be proud if you had something like that and say, you know, for this, I'm going to remember the rest of my life. because this is a big part of my life and big part of all my friends' life and the ones that died for it. You got to remember all of them. I got to live to be 80 years old, but then poor guys down there, they were 19, 20, 21, are not here anymore. They're goners.
The war will never leave me. It'll be with me in that part of the brain where it's huddled up. But the tragedies in that are passed off. And now we're facing a new thing. Our members are passing away, and that brings some sadness back.
I think that in the past few years, many Americans are waking up to the fact of the veteran of World War II. On Veterans Day, my own grandson called me. He said, "Thanks, Grandpa."
Men of Metz.
There's damn few of us left.
This is nice. It turned out nice.
Yeah.
We got the sun, guys. Right?
I'm going to go take a walk down to the cemetery.
Oh, I got to go down there.
Yeah,
too.
I got to go down there.
Do you know where your guy is?
Somebody told me he's right in the front on the right side as we go in, yeah.
I don't
know who it is, but that's what I was told. The guy from my company.
Before him.
No.
You haven't?
Mm. This is my first time and it's my last time because in 5 years I'll be pushing up Davies.
No.
No?
No. Yeah.
I'll be pushing up petunias then, right? Instead of Davies.
This is really something, guys.
It is.
There they are, see them? I've never been here before.
Whew. 10,700, Nick.
Is that how many?
10,700.
Hey, Nick.
Biggest World War II cemetery.
Whew. Look at them all, huh? Holy mackerels. Wonder if they got a log on that with the names and all that.
I don't know.
Huh?
I don't know, but it sure gets to you, doesn't it?
Yeah. And this is just one of them.
Yeah.
Just think all them guys are gone. Man alive.
Going across this field and the sniper shot Lieutenant Baxter.
You remember when Baxter got it?
I was with him.
You were, yeah.
Unfortunately. I was, since I was a platoon runner, I was with Lieutenant Wilder when he was hit, with Lieutenant Baxter when he was killed, and then Sergeant Knutson was the acting platoon leader, and I was talking to him when he was killed. I guess I wasn't a very good,
good look on.
They took 62% of them back to the States. Because this guy got a computer up there, tells you every cemetery, you know, the guys that got killed in that. But I thought we had more in here, but there's too many crosses to go through. You know, there's a lot of guys, but not from the engineers. You know, they're from the infantry in that. But I don't think we got any more here, guys. .377, that was Chuck's outfit. You know that Chuck Wood?
Mm-hmm. Let's get to Company A people first.
Okay.
G.
G?
Yeah,
G's
that's...
G's the walk.
Through the walk, okay.
Because I got hit on December the 5th, and my kid brother got captured in the bulge on December the 20, 19th or 20th or something.
But see, we were still in those buildings, you know, right after we crossed the bridge.
Yeah.
And Renfro, I think, was...
Because I know, I think it was the 5th that I got hit. So my mother got a Christmas present of two sons. One shot up and the other one captured.
Charles Armstrong?
Oh, where?
Right there.
Company A.
Stay in front.
Yes. Yeah, he was Company A. I'll be darned. Yeah, I remember him very well. He still owes me $10.
I gotta tell Chuck all of his guys, you know, that went, the 377th.
They really paid a lot of respect here. I wish everybody in the States could come here.
Your memory is, Nick?
Well, it's good enough to get me to the gambling boat and go to the toilet.
What are you doing with all the pictures?
Just shooting.
Just shooting?
I'm not here, man.
Huh?
I'm not here.
You're not here?
No.
Is that the camera you're gonna shoot with over there?
I'm not here.
This is the Army, Mr. Jones. No private rooms or telephones. Had your breakfast in bed before, but you won't have it there anymore. This is the Army, Mr. Brown. You and your baby went to town. She had you worried, but this is war, and she won't worry you anymore. This is the Army, Mr. Jones.